sighted are going to be gallstone-related biliary tract obstruction, and ultrasound is going to be your imaging modality of choice in these patients. For evaluation of the biliary tract can be quite challenging. This will include evaluation of the liver for intrahepatic duct facilitation. It's going to include evaluation of the gallbladder, the neck, and it's also going to include evaluation of the common bile duct. For those of you who don't know, this is really from the famous bank robber over 100 years ago, and he's famous for having said that he robs banks because that's where the money is. What we're going to be doing on the first entry-level gallbladder exam is focusing directly on the sonographic findings of the gallbladder. This is going to be much easier to interpret and to perform at the beginning level than to try and teach common bile duct evaluation. We'll be teaching that at a later point, but early on, it's unrealistic to expect that you're going to grasp both to evaluate the gallbladder as well as the intrahepatic ductal systems. So the important point to remember here is that the decision for operative management should only be made after the CBD has been evaluated, because up to 15-18% of patients sonographically have cholecystitis will also have cholecystitis, and the operative intervention is going to be different for cholecystitis versus cholecystitis. Cholecystitis is basically the gallbladder out. This is cholecystitis, is another ERCP for CBD stone extraction, followed by cholecystectomy. Now let's first look at the sagittal gallbladder exam. Let's look at exam essentials. In terms of transducers, you can use a 2 to 5 MHz curvilinear or phased array transducer. I prefer using a large footprint curvilinear transducer for these exams. In terms of patient position, I initially start the patient off in the supine position, but if I see a stone, I'm going to have to do the exam in two positions, especially the stone by the neck, to confirm that the stone is labile and not obstructing the neck. So I usually do supine and then left lateral to this position. In terms of preparation, I do the position to the MCO, but in the ED, on the symptomatic or the suspected symptomatic patient, the exam should be performed regardless of their cranial status. Here's an example of the right upper quadrant sagittal window going from lateral to medial. So here we're starting off. You see the liver, so the stranger, posterior, head, and foot. Here's the diaphragm. Here's the right pleural space here. Here you've got the kidney. So to remove the transducer immediately, we're now going to bring the gallbladder into view. And here you can see the fundus of the gallbladder, and here you can see the neck. It's really important that you, when evaluating the gallbladder, make shadow manipulation so that you can evaluate the neck, because this is where the pathologic stones are going to reside. When scanning the gallbladder in the sagittal plane, it's always important to look for the vein lobar fissure, because it's a fixed anatomic relationship. The right coronal vein is connected to the gallbladder by the vein lobar fissure. So this will be times that you look at other anatomic structures in the right upper quadrant, and you may think to yourself, am I looking at the gallbladder? Try to identify the vein lobar fissure and its relationship to the right coronal vein. This will help you to confirm that what you're looking at is indeed the gallbladder. Once you're scanning, you can't find the gallbladder. All you see is this. You're as close to the subsite or the costal margin as possible, and you still can't see the gallbladder. All you see is this dirty shadow from bile gas. What you should do is have the patient take in a deep breath. And there you go. Now you can see liver, and you can see gallbladder here. Remember, anything that's close to the diaphragm is going to be affected by respiration. Here, having the patient take in a deep breath will help you in visualizing the gallbladder. Let's see if you can find the gallbladder, but you actually need to see the liver. Now you guys think of the other potential causes. One, think of the gallbladder's absence. Laparoscopic cholecystectomy scars are not as obvious as the open scars were. Sometimes patients forget that they have their gallbladder out, and you're looking and you don't see anything, and it's because it's surgically absent. Another option is that the gallbladder could be contracted. Here's the coronal vein here, here's the vein lobar fissure, and this is a completely contracted gallbladder in someone who had just eaten. The other possibility is that the gallbladder is filled with stones, and I'll show some examples of that in a little bit here, and it's possible that the rest of the patient could have an ectopic location for their gallbladder. There's some examples of contracted gallbladders, and these can be very difficult to find, especially in the beginning stages of your career. So again, you're going to have to rely heavily on the vein lobar fissure and the anatomic association of the right coronal vein. For the here, here's another patient who's just eaten, and you can see there's still some bile within the here. This will make it easier to see, but this gallbladder is contracted because the patient has just eaten. But here you can see, vein lobar fissure, gallbladder was over here, here's my coronal vein. So I'm comfortable in this relationship right here that I can confirm that this is indeed the gallbladder. For example, here's a patient whose gallbladder is filled with scars. So as we're scanning along, here's the right coronal, here's the vein lobar fissure, so we know the gallbladder is coming up. And here what we see is, here's the gallbladder, it's partially contracted, here's a large epigenetic stone, we see the clean shadowing behind it. Here you see a little bit of bile. So as we look at it again, this is one that could be potentially missed by the beginning scanner. So you're going to be looking for clean shadowing here, just not what you would expect from bile gas. And so this would be your first clue that this is the gallbladder here and that this is just a very large stone within there. What about the transverse exam? Whether you start in the sagittal or the transverse plane is a personal preference. I like to start sagittally, but I know some of my peers start off in the transverse plane, so whatever works for you is fine. If you start off in the transverse plane, you're going to be in the subcostal region and up the discolibular line, indicator towards the patient's right. So you've got anterior, posterior, patient's right, patient's left. Here you've got liver, here you've got the right kidney, the gallbladder, and the anterior and medial to the superior pole of the right kidney. For the transverse exam, a sweep going from the cephaloid region caudally. So you start off. Here you can see the gallbladder, now we're moving down towards the fundus, and we come back up. This is going to be the gallbladder neck here. On patients who have an S-shaped gallbladder or a relatively tortuous neck, I think it's easier to follow the neck in the transverse plane as we're seeing here. So you can see there's a neck going into the fundus. A couple examples of contracted gallbladders in the transverse plane here. You can see the walls here, and here you can see the lumen, but there's essentially no bile in there. Here you can see on this transverse, there's a little bit of bile in there, making it easier to conclude that this is gallbladder. But you can see that it's significantly contracted. And this is also a patient who just eaten. Here's a transverse sweep of a patient whose gallbladder is filled with stones. So really, what you're going to be looking for when you catch your eye first is just clean shadowing. Let's look now at how you can evaluate the gallbladder with ultrasound. Ideally, the gallbladder has been described as being oval or pear-shaped, and you can see that here. This has a nice oval or pear-shape to it. But there's going to be a lot of variations to the shape of the gallbladder, and you need to be aware of this when scanning the right upper quadrant. Here are examples of Phrygian caps, and these are folds in the fundus of the gallbladder. So these are both sagittal, these gallbladder. You can see here's a third, and the front is right here. This is called a ferrugine cap. Although not very common here, you've got a gallbladder that has multiple cavitations within it. This theoretically poses an increased risk for gallstone development, and you've got xanthomas and junctional folds on these sagittal views down by the neck. Here you can see one. Here you can see a fold right here. So these are actually very common. What are gallstones going to look like? Unless they're intact, they're going to be mobile. So remember, if you gallstones, especially by the neck, you got to deal with these banana two positions because of our mobility. They're going to be epigenetic, and they're going to cast clean, crucible shadows. So you have a gallbladder that is multiple epigenetic stones with clean shadows behind it. There's a slight ball over sitting up on top here. These are all gallstones. Hi, I'm Dr. Jones, and welcome to the introductory abdominal sound lecture. Evaluating this gallbladder, I'd like to use the tissue harmonics feature. You can think of which allows for crisper appearances of the wall, and it also produces nicer and cleaner posterior shadowing. It'll be done between patient, change scanning time, and all I did was here was add tissue harmonics. This is without tissue harmonics. I think that the wall borders are more discernible, and I think the shadowing is more readily apparent, and the gallstones are more epigenetic. But even tiny gallstone shadow, if you've got your settings correct, that you're using the highest frequency, and you've got your focal zones assigned to the right level, gallstones greater than 3 millimeters should cast posterior shadowing. You look at a stone here that was not casting any shadowing, but all these other ones were. This stone that is under 3 millimeters. And so keep in mind that if you've got very tiny stones, they may not cast posterior shadowing. Visualizing the neck is going to be essential because this is where the obstruction is going to occur. So you've got to make sure that you do gentle twisting movements in order to bring out the neck. Here's a patient that had clinically a strong epic word VP, regular King John. He said they couldn't find a gallstone with a pretty tender over that spot, and the gallbladder appeared large. So I did the paperclip that they swept through. And they really weren't seeing the neck, but the patient was exquisitely tender right over that point, and it was very suspicious that this patient did have a gallstone obstructing down the neck. So I went ahead and scanned the patient, and by gently twisting the transducer and allowing visualization of the neck, I was able to see that there was a stone sitting here, and I moved the patient into several other positions and was unable to get the stone to free up. So this was the reason for the patient's pain right here, and all it took was some shadow twisting of the transducer in order to bring out better visualization of the neck. But it's essential that you visualize your gallbladder neck. If you're having a hard time in the transverse plane, remember, go into transverse plane, it's easier to sweep up and down and visualize from the fundus all the way to the neck. In the literature, you'll see the term less complex views, and that means wall echo shadow. And that's what you're going to see when you've got the gallbladder that's packed with multiple stones or one large stone, then you have the wall, the echo, and the shadow here. And basically, on this patient here, you really don't see any bile, it's just the wall, the echo, and the shadow. What about sludge? Sludge is either cholesterol or calcium polyglutamate, or cholesterol crystals or calcium polyglutamate granules. They're going to be energetic, they're not going to shadow, and they'll be mobile. You'll see a changing position in the patient. You'll go from supine to left lateral facetious to right lateral facetious position. Here the patient that came in and right at the quadrant pain, you look here. And does not have the nice anacolumen that you'd expect. There's layered epigenetic area here. There's no posterior shadowing, and there's no mobile as the patient's turn from position to position. This is consistent with something such as sludge. But is sludge the only possibility? There's a good proof of history from this patient that had recently had a liver biopsy. And so this is actually hemophilia. So it's important to remember, clotted blood will have the same appearance as sludge. This is the same thing you're going to see when you're doing soft tissue ultrasound. Ultrasound will not help you differentiate a hematoma from an abscess. It's not going to help you in the pelvis to distinguish clotted hemoperitoneum from pus. So just keep that in mind. We're going to talk about gallbladder polyps. The primary goal in the management of gallbladder polyps is to prevent the development of gallbladder carcinoma. So who's high risk for developing gallbladder carcinoma? So this is a solitary polyp greater than 6 millimeters. With an age greater than 50 years old, it's high risk for malignancy. If polyps are not going to be removed by a cholecystectomy, then they need to be followed by serial exam. And it's important to keep that in mind. Polyps are going to be epigenetic areas within the lumen. They're not going to be mobile, and they should not cast the shadowing. But if you see these people now finding, you want to make sure that you refer the patient for follow-up. What about hair within the lumen? I'm always harping on. Recognize reverberation when you see them. Hair in the wrong place is never good. Well, emphysema is closed despite it accounts for less than 1% of all cases. These are usually more advanced cases, and these patients can be sicker. Here's a CT here. You can see that there's a large amount of air anteriorly here within the gallbladder. And on ultrasound, you can see that there are multiple epigenetic areas here with posterior reverberations, all consistent with the presence of air. This is something you want to be able to diagnose. This is a patient that came with right upper quadrant pain. The intern that was scanning was having a hard time identifying the gallbladder. And when they were scanning this area right here, they saw all these dirty shadowing and reverberations here. They saw this epigenetic line right here, but they assumed that this was just bowel gas. You can see here that this is bile right here. If you look transversely, anterior and medial to the superior fold of the right kidney, here you've got the gallbladder. Here you've got air within the gallbladder lumen. You've got stones here. And you can see intermittently there's little epigenetic foci moving up to the surface here. Those are gas bubbles from the gas lung infection. You see it moving up right there. This is a patient with epistemitis cholecystitis, although the clip I have here sadly doesn't confirm it. We're on other views we're able to confirm that this area connected by the main lobar fissure down here over to the right portal vein. So remember, if you see these epigenetic areas with posterior reverbs, be ready to make the diagnosis of epistemitis cholecystitis. The size matter and the answer is yes. A gallbladder with a transverse diameter outer wall to outer wall is greater than 45 centimeters. That should raise your suspicion of cholecystitis. Sagittally, the gallbladder should be less than 10 centimeters. However, this number does not correlate as well as the transverse width measurement does. There's a caveat. The absence of dilatation does not exclude the presence of obstruction, particularly early on in the timeline. Can gallbladder wall thickness help you? Sure. But in conjunction with other findings, not by itself. Normal wall thickness should be measured anteriorly. You don't want to do it posteriorly because it's difficult to discern the gallbladder wall and the bowel borders. It's easier to do it up here with the liver. But normally, the thickness should be less than 3 millimeters. However, wall thickening is a non-specific finding. You don't have to memorize a list. This is teaching and believing. This differential is pretty extensive for gallbladder wall thickening. So alone, gallbladder wall thickening cannot be used to make the diagnosis of cholecystitis. This patient with any date and age, she had hepatitis, and she also had multiple intra-abdominal pseudomonal abscesses. She was in her gallbladder, she did not have acute biliary disease. But as you look, she's got massive thickening of the walls. Now transverse. You can see that there's massive thickening of the walls, but this is not due to acute cholecystitis. This is a patient that had gallbladder wall thickening. If you take a look here, here's the wall here. This is also a wall. It's not uncommon to see in the middle portion a central hypoechoic area. Now, at first glance, you may want to look and say, oh, here's gallbladder wall. This is paracholecystic fluid. But you really want to trace the whole outline of the gallbladder. This was the outer wall here of the gallbladder wall, or the outer portion of the gallbladder wall. This is just some edema in the middle portion here, so there's no paracholecystic fluid. Just the wall thickening. We talked about this on the back exam lecture. The free fluid is going to butt up against adjacent structures and give you these triangular corners. And you see here, there is paracholecystic fluid here coming up. And you see it's got no wall around it. It's got nice triangular corners. It's important to remember that paracholecystic fluid can be a biliary or non-biliary origin. So know that paracholecystic fluid can be a non-specific finding. In the literature, it's defined as they're broken down into type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is going to be a thin anechoic crescent-shaped collection. Type 2 is going to be a round or irregularly shaped collection. Here you can see a triangular-shaped fluid collection here between the kidney and the gallbladder. Here you can see that this gallbladder is enlarged. It's greater than 5 centimeters. There's multiple stones here, and it's paracholecystic fluid. The patient also had a sonographic mercury sign and was diagnosed as acute cholecystitis. The CTD had been visualized prior to the patient going to the operating room, and it was normal in size. We're going to talk about the common bowel evaluation in future modules. So how can just looking at the gallbladder alone help you? Well, if you have a patient that comes in, right over quadrant pain, you look at the literature. 23% of the time, when we suspect somebody has acute cholecystitis or symptomatic biliary disease, we're wrong. If you look, and you see that patient has a normal gallbladder, there's an absence of stones, absence of wall thickening, no paracholecystic fluid, and a sonographic mercury, and absence of a sonographic mercury sign, that essentially rules out the diagnosis of acute biliary disease. Let me spend a second clarifying the sonographic mercury sign. By definition, it's reproducible point tenderness directly over the gallbladder with transducer pressure, 87% specific for the diagnosis of cholecystitis. And the presence of gallstones in combination with a positive sonographic mercury sign has a 92% positive predictive value for the diagnosis of acute cholecystitis. But it really has to be reproducible point tenderness, not global tenderness over the right upper quadrant, including the gallbladder, point tenderness directly over the gallbladder. But if you have a patient who needs to find gallstones, and they have local tenderness, meaning a sonographic mercury sign, you got to remember here that up to 18% of these patients will also have associated PVD stones, and therefore operative intervention should not be planned until you have a comprehensive exam done where the common bile duct is evaluated.
What bile acids we use to find these complications, and what is the category we would then give to the complications? So this is case one. Case two, again, what are your descriptors, and what's your final assessment? Case three, again, descriptors and assessment. And case four, how would you describe it, and what's your assessment? Even those of us who do mammography as our specialty find complications trouble comes sometimes. And so my task in the 20 to 30 minutes is to give you an organized way to approach a seemingly disorganized body. And this framework is essentially viral, but it's a way of approaching complications that you can use on a daily basis in the reader. So to begin with, there are two cases. Most breast complications are typically benign, and they are benign in a very recognizable way. And it's key to be able to recognize those complications and realize that you don't have to do anything else for them. Now, those complications that are not typically benign, you then go on and analyze two pieces of information, the morphology and the distribution. And the morphology and the distribution, the words that you pick to describe those things will guide you to your assessment category. So today we're going to very quickly go over BILAB. Then we'll spend some time talking about typically benign complications, and the rest of the time we'll be spent talking about the way of analyzing the rest of the complications, meaning the distribution and the morphology. So let's go with BILABs. As you know, there's six categories. And you can split them up by what's the means for management. So the first two categories is used routine screening. The third category is something you try not to use very often, but it's guided to use short-term follow-up. Categories 4 and 5 is used to biopsy. Now the difference is that for BILAB 5, you are 95% sure that this is a cancer. So if you do a biopsy and it turns out to be benign, you're not satisfied with that, and you go on to a surgical biopsy. So that's the difference between those two. And 6 is the number one thing. So we're going to move on to typically benign complications. There's 9 categories, which means there's a lot of things, you know, a lot of these. So let's start with the first one. You recognize this from MSK. These are your vascular calcifications. So they're not always this obvious, and you need to distinguish these from the linear calcifications that you would otherwise biopsy. So how do you distinguish it? Two things. The transect appearance of the calcification and the soft tissue along with the vessel. And that soft tissue that you see with the vessel should track with the calcifications of all of these that you take. The next category is skin. Skin is two things going for it. It has two locations, such as the inframammary fold along the sternum and the axilla. And if you look at the calcifications carefully, they should be tightly clustered, and often you'll find a couple that are loose and centered. And that should usually give you enough information, but sometimes it won't. In those cases, when you patient back for diagnostics, you put the BD right on the calcifications. You prove it to yourself, and you should have the BD right on top of the calcifications, and then you do a tangential view, and you look to see whether those calcifications triangulate the skin. If they do, you're done. So just one more example. On your left, the calcifications are triangulating to the skin, and they're benign. On your right-hand example, you see the BD and the underlying skin, and the calcifications are within the superficial breast brain, and they need additional workup because they are in the breast. So our next category. And your basal lymph centers or atria, so these are lucent, but they do have lymph calcification that can be continuous or discontinuous, and they're benign, and leave them alone. Moving on, that same category are dystrophic calcifications, which also have a lucent center, which, as you can see, can evolve over time, become more coarse. They're usually very thin, and they usually have some sort of background of radiation or trauma or surgery. So just one more example of dystrophic calcifications. Sometimes dystrophic calcifications can be toppable. So if you can get a view like this, showing that the calcifications are on the side of the top, and all you see are dystrophic calcifications in the lucent centers, you're done. Our next category are hetero complications. and you can see they work near me, they would calcify, you don't see nothing, but you can see them. Our next category are closure popcorn complications, which are usually seen with a private item that's involving. They're usually large, thick, closure complications, which may sometimes have a soft tissue with a mass associated with them, but sometimes not. By the way, they're considered benign. The next category are secretory calcifications, which are large, rod-like calcifications, which are usually bilateral and extending towards the nipple. There's more than one type. They can be intraductal, going to ducts, as you see here, or they can be periductal, surrounding the ducts. Either way, they're benign. Now we're going to move on to the injections. Now there's many different types of injections. I'm showing you two. These are silicone on the left. They have this cotton candy, cloudy appearance. And the paraffin injections, on the other hand, are the loosen-centered calcifications of the nipple. Either way, benign. Now this last category is in the time. On the lateral, you see these meniscoid linear calcifications. And on the CT here, we see almost nothing. But if you look in the center, you'll see some amorphous cloudy calcifications that are very difficult to see. This is a nodal calcification. So the key nodal calcification is noting that it's dependent calcifications in macro or microcystis. And that they look different on the different views. So on the lateral, you'll see percentage shapes or curvilinear calcifications. And on the CT, you will have cortex findings. And if you do find them, you'll see these round amorphous deposits. So on the schematic view, you'll see, again, see the curvilinear appearance on the lateral. And this bottom of the teacup view on the CC. And the key, again, is to change the shape of the articles under compression. So if you see linear calcifications on your CC, they are not nodal calcium. Only if they change shape and they are amorphous on the CC, are they have nodal calcium. Alright, so that covers our nine categories of typical benign. We're going to move on to the rest. So let's start with distribution. You have five terms that you can use for distribution. And I'm going to from benign to most suspicious. So diffuse regional group linear and so we'll go over these. So diffuse calcifications are scattered throughout the breast and they suggest a benign process. This is what it would look like. Now notice that diffuse calcifications doesn't mean that they're evenly distributed calcifications. Diffuse calcifications randomly cluster, but the key to knowing that they're diffuse is that no cluster looks very different from any other cluster. They all look very similar. So this is what it would look like on a mammogram. And the calcifications are sort of a catch-all. They usually need a large volume of tissue that has calcifications, but they're not quite segmental, they're not quite diffuser. They're not industrial distributions. Again, they suggest the benign process. So this would be the way it would look like on schematic. And this is what it would look like on mammogram. All right, our next category is close to a cluster. This, by definition, is five or more calcification distributed CC of tissue. It's a neutral term. It doesn't mean suspicious or not suspicious, it's neutral. So, for example, we have two clusters here. The cluster on your left has round calcifications, the cluster on your right has cluster machine calcifications, the management is very different. The round calcifications can actually turn out to be a bilateral breach or follow, and whereas the cluster machine is your always biopsy. So, the morphology is really going to dictate what's going to happen, and for breach or cluster calcifications. And moving on to our next category, which is linear, obviously, the calcifications are aligned, and suggest deposits and adjust, these are always suspicious. So, this is what it will look like in schematic, and on mammogram, again, you see the calcifications line up, and they're actually branching. These are very suspicious. It's always biopsy. So segmental distribution is our very last category, and it's the most distribution we have. This suggests deposits along the central distribution can get very suspicious. And as you can see here, you have calcifications that are lining up pointing towards the nipple. On a mammogram, it will look something like this. Now, it doesn't really matter what sort of calcifications you have, those are highly suspicious, and you would definitely biopsy those. So now we're going to move on to morphology. And let me say before we go on to the specific term, the importance of spot compression identification views. So try not to make a determination on the morphology of the calcifications until you see those spot nag views, because you can be fooled. So for example, say we have this appearance on your normal mammogram. It looks somewhat amorphous, it's something that I would normally biopsy. But on the spot, you're seeing that all of these are actually round calcifications. That completely changes your management. So now this was revised when you found the virus facial to follow. So make sure you get the spot nag before you decide on your morphology. Alright, so now we're going to talk about the five terms. I noted them from benign to most suspicious. Round amorphous, coarse vision is finally more than you can find in your vision. So let's show the round calcifications. These are small round or punctate calcifications and are usually benign. So this is how you draw them. They are very clear, distinct, round, 50 different sizes. So if you draw a cluster of round calcifications, they look benign. So they're usually benign, and so the distribution matters. If they're scattered, they're divided by one or two. If you're a cluster, if you're seeing them for the first time, they might be divided by three, which is closer to one. If they're new, you really don't have a choice, you still need to biopsy them. If they're in a linear or segmental distribution, you would still absolutely biopsy them because the distribution is on the morphology. So here's an example of round calcifications, which are clusters, and therefore divided by three on a baseline. Now this is another example of round calcifications, but now they're in a linear distribution. So this would be a bilateral score in your biopsy. Okay, moving on to our next category, which is amorphous calcifications. These are small, deep calcifications that are very hazy, borders are difficult to see, and are apparently inconsistent. So when I draw them for you, they look something like this. But you can't really see the edges. You don't know if they're round or square or triangular because you can't see them very well. In fact, they're very hard to see on the mammogram at all. So on the mammogram, I had to circle them so you could see a little bit better. They're usually very difficult to see, and you just cannot see those edges. This is like another example of amorphous calcifications. Now, there are apparently inconsistent, but not alone. Thank you.